Again, I'm Mike Canning with Duke Corporate Education, and welcome to the fourth installment of our Duke CE Leadership Series. We at Duke CE are dedicated to getting leaders ready for what's next. And as an extension of this work, the Leadership Series brings the latest thinking from world-class experts on topics leaders really need to know. Today, we're very pleased to have Heather McGowan and Chris Shipley with us to explore the topic of the future of learning and work, a fast-changing and important topic to all of us these days. So first, let me introduce our guest speakers. Really pleased they're here. Heather first. Heather McGowan is an internationally known speaker, writer, thought leader, and specializes in this area of how we need to respond to the rapid and disruptive changes we're experiencing in work, education, and broadly in society. Last year, she was voted the number one global voice for education on LinkedIn Media. And she works with corporate executives and the heads of educational institutions to help them rethink their business models, organization structures, and other things about how they're actually working these two areas and disciplines together, work and education, to be more resilient and relevant in a fast-changing world. She also has a wealth of clinical and practical experience as she works with clients from startups to many in the Fortune 500. So, Heather, say hello.
Heather, thanks. Thank you so much for having me and having Chris here today to ponder this very important topic. Chris and I have been both batting this around for about a decade, and we crossed paths about 4 years ago. And the conversation, which started in Australia, still hasn't ended. So we've had the good fortune of working together, and we look forward to sharing our thoughts with you guys today.
Thanks a lot, Heather. Hey, and Chris, thanks so much for being here. Chris Shipley partnered with Heather and was a leading technology analyst for more than 25 years, built her career identifying innovative startups that create markets and drive some of this disruptive change. And in addition to her leading edge work with Heather, she also consults with growth stage startups around the world and is head of business strategy for a Pittsburgh-based startup, Sparked. Chris is also doing some groundbreaking work, not only from a research standpoint, but really what are the practical applications of some of this for some of our organizations and our leaders. So Chris, say hello.
Good morning, everyone. It's really a pleasure to be here. These webcasts for me and I think for Heather too, create an opportunity for us to learn a lot as we go. So we're looking forward to this being a learning experience for everyone.
Fantastic. Thanks, Chris. So here's the game plan. Over the next 40 minutes, you'll hear from both Heather and then Chris, and then we'll work our way through. As you're listening, if your questions come to mind, as Michael said, just drop those over and submit those as we go. Don't wait till the end. It's much easier if you just write the questions as they come to you. We'll track those and answer as many of your questions as we can towards the end of the session. So let's get started. If I could ask you to go to the next slide, Michael. Hey, Heather, one could say, you know, for all of us that change is not really a new topic. We've been learning about change and change management and been dealing with change probably across our careers. But what's really different now? And why do we need a more fundamental rethink about this link between learning and work? If I could ask you to just maybe start there and walk through some of your thoughts on that, it would be great.
Sure. We're entering, or rather, we're in the greatest velocity of change in human history. So while there's always been change, the speed of that change and the number of cycles we're having to go through as humans is unprecedented. The way that I work is to explain some of this change to people, understand what it means to them, and help them find their place in it. So this series of visuals I'm going to offer to kick off this conversation is sort of meant to be sort of a bit of a handrail for us.
You have the slides, Heather?
No.
Michael, can you pass control to Heather?
Ah, there we go. Okay, I'll start by explaining what's happening from a macro context standpoint.
And maybe a micro, like what's happening with the slides.
Yeah. We just rehearsed this right before we got on.
Just the delay, Heather, you should have it now.
Okay. It was good to have a moment to reflect.
There you go.
Okay, there we go. So in my travels, I've had the good fortune of crossing paths with New York Times Pulitzer Prize winning columnist Thomas Friedman, who wrote both The World is Flat, his seminal work, and then his most recent work, Thank You for Being Late, Thriving in the Age of Accelerations. And in his latest book, I think he does the best job of explaining the sort of macro context of change we're going through. He refers to it as three climate changes. So first is the climate of technology, second is the climate of the climate, and third is the climate of the market. So the climate and technology follows Moore's law, where computing power is doubling every 18 to 24 months while dropping in half in price. And a way to wrap your head around this kind of velocity of technological driven change is if you took a 1971 Volkswagen Beetle and you put it on the same path as Moore's law, today it would get 300,000 miles per gallon. It would go 300,000 miles per hour, get 2 million miles per gallon, and cost 4 cents. That's the velocity of technological driven change we've seen in our lifetime. And if you look at the climate change of the climate of the climate, the recent UN report says we have about 12 years to change our human behaviors to avoid more catastrophic events. A recent report that came out yesterday said that we have to triple the efforts of the Paris Climate Agreement, which we in the U.S. have withdrawn from. And we're seeing the effects of climate change in the mass migrations around the world. We have more people moving around the world trying to get out of the worlds of disorder, climate-driven disorder, to the worlds of order than ever in human history, certainly since World War II. And then the climate of the market is really globalization, which at one point in time was stuff on shipping containers, and now it's digital flows. There are no frictions or barriers to digital flows. So one of these couple examples I like to use is when Obama went in and reopened the embassy in Cuba, 3 months later, there were over 2,000 Airbnb listings. We could have never built hotels that quickly. We never could have scaled up that quickly, but digital flows enabling physical actions allow us to scale up and down all over the world. Right now, the top 10 populations in the world, only two of them are countries. The other eight are social media platforms, and all of that happened in the last 5 years. So those are the three climate changes that are reshaping our world. And he says they're reshaping them across five dimensions: work and learning, politics, geopolitics, community, and ethics. Work and learning is lifelong learning and adaptation is now a norm, and that's what we'll be speaking about primarily today. Politics and geopolitics, no more left and right. Both political parties are blowing up. Geopolitics, our enemies and allies are now shifting in a way they weren't before. Community, it's now more about ideology than geography. You may find you have greater senses of community in online environments where you find people connect with you that are not your next door neighbors. And ethics, we need entirely new guardrails to deal with some of these technologies. So one of the things that struck me is I usually walk through Friedman's stuff, and then I go into more depth and texture about the technology-driven change. After a bunch of my recent talks, people come up to me afterwards, and they were crying. And it really struck me to see that kind of raw emotion in what is a pretty fact-based discussion. And one of the things I discovered is that humans are under tremendous stress. This change is something, the winds of this change are something we're not prepared for, we're not dealing with, we're not preparing people for in either learning environments or work environments. And so I started charting some of the cultural changes that were taking place because I suddenly realized that the only thing moving more quickly than technology is cultural change. So I started making some lists, which I'll get into in a second. But one of the things that's really roiling people today is job loss. Job loss is a norm. We don't act like it's a norm, but it is a norm. You're going to lose your job. Maybe the one you had, maybe you've already lost a job. In studies of studies that look at a number of studies across the globe on the impact of job loss, they discovered that losing your job can take twice as long to recover from than losing your primary relationship. And that may seem odd, but it makes complete sense to me because what's the first thing we ask to each other? What do you do? Our primary identity is tied to our occupation, and it's act like it's fixed when it's really fluid. So I don't think we have anything in place other than outplacement services to really prepare people for job loss and change. So I mentioned before that the list that I made, going to talk about occupational identity first. So when we used to talk about what do you want to be when you grow up, we still ask kids that today. It's a completely absurd question when you consider this figure has been batted around, maybe right, maybe wrong, maybe low, too low, probably is too high, probably is too, it is not too high, it's probably too low. 65% of jobs do not exist yet today for kids in grade school, but we're asking kids what they want to be when they grow up, and we're limiting their ideas about their future self based upon the few things they're approached with today. This is the Frey Osborne model. Maybe 47% of current work tasks will be automated. Maybe higher than that, maybe lower than that. No matter how you look at it, 100% of jobs are going to change. We're myopically focused on university students picking their major before they set foot on campus and often before they even apply. The best research I've seen on this from the Federal Reserve Bank in New York said that less than a third of people ever work in the field of their undergraduate major. So why are we so myopically focused on that rather than preparing people for a lifelong learning? And then what do you do? The best research I've seen in this, particularly for the developing world, was out of the Foundation for Young Australians that says that young people today will have upwards of 17 jobs across 5 different industries. So if we're asking people, what do you want to be when you grow up? And we're asking university students to myopically focus on a single occupation, if not discipline or industry, we're really limiting their future. We're limiting their mindsets. So I mentioned earlier the parameters of cultural change. And this is when I started making a list and realizing that the velocity of cultural change is the only thing moving faster than the velocity of technology. This is primarily US information, but it applies to many aspects of the developed world. So in the US, from a race standpoint, we have long been a white majority. We will soon be a white minority. This is really unsettling for a lot of people. Religion, we have been a Christian. We say Judeo-Christian, but it's really Christian norm. We're moving more towards an unaffiliated or a plurality of religions. In 2015, Harvard entered their first class that had more atheists than Christians. It's not becoming a norm to be secular, unaffiliated. Region, we have been more urban for quite some time, but we have rural roots and we use rural expressions all the time. In the next 2 decades, we'll have 90% of our population living on 3.5% of our land mass in a handful of states, which has a lot of implications, certain political implications in terms of representation. Our politics, we've been about a third, Republican, Democrat, and independent, going back many decades. Now we're highly polarized, and we've got about 43%, according to Pew, that are independent that don't find either party fits. Age, we have been a youth and middle-aged culture. Look at our advertising. Everything is geared towards youth. We will soon be an aging society. In 2027, we will have more walkers than strollers. That means there will be more people over 65 than under 14. Family, we've been mom, dad, and 2.5 kids. The year I was born, 2.5 was the average number of kids. It's now 1.8, so we're looking at middle child extinction. And a plurality of types of family. It's not just mom and dad, it's mom and dad and dad, and mom and grandpa, and cousins and aunts and uncles, all sorts of different types of family formations. This next marker, I think, is the one that's changing the most quickly, as far as I could tell. Gender identity has long been fixed and binary, at least socialized fixed and binary, and now it's very much fluid. If you're in an academic institution, it's not unusual to have at the bottom of your email the pronouns you prefer. And it's not unusual to ask people what pronouns they prefer, not assuming that it's he or she. When Ruby Rose opened the European American Music Awards in the last year or so, she said, welcome, ladies and gentlemen, and everyone in between. And I thought that expression really summed up where we are rather suddenly. Consent. This is not something we're usually comfortable talking about. We have to acknowledge that for quite some time, particularly around the 50s when women started entering the workforce, sexual harassment was permissible. It was just acceptable behavior. And now the Me Too and the Time's Up movement have really changed the power structure of what's acceptable. Occupation. We've long been a fixed employee identity. We ask each other what we do, and we're moving towards a portfolio of self-expression, which is more internally based, and I'll get a little bit more into that in a second. Leadership, we have been a white male patriarchy, and we're seeing more diversity and more female leaders. We just elected over 100 female representatives to government. Expertise, long been earned and credentialed. It's now moving towards personal brand and network, and that has implications both for companies but also for individuals. And then where we get our news and where we find out what's true, we used to be a fact-based debate. We had different perspectives, but we all had a common set of facts. Now we're dealing with fake news and loss of trust in news organizations as well as institutions. So all of these factors taken together, I think, are creating an identity crisis that have real implications in work, which I'll get to in a second. So we look at disrupting work. I think the world of work used to look like this. Education existed in one band, career existed in another, retirement existed in another. Education, whether you went to university or not, was the first 30 of your life. Then you got on the career escalator, you collected your pension, and you died a year later. That was by design. Success in this world was, did we accurately codify and transfer predetermined skills and existed knowledge to create a deployable workforce? Is one SIG, we got you that first good job, you were sort of all set. Now I think it looks more like this. Life expectancy is not 90 yet in the US, but it will be soon. It'll soon be 100. Education becomes learning because education implies an end state of being educated where learning is continuous. Career becomes leverage and it overlaps with learning. And retirement becomes longevity, which overlaps with leverage. Learning is irrefutably lifelong. And work becomes a series of engagements, some of which overlap. We remain engaged. And success measures here are about learning agility, adaptability, and agency fueled by purpose. And I'll get into that a little more in a second. So one of the things that I think is happening to work, the easiest way that Chris and I tend to explain it is the three A's. So first, work has been atomized, which means it's been broken into job fragments that can often be done anywhere around the world. Digitalization enabled this, so everyone's familiar with Uber. Catalent is previously called Hourly Nerd, is disrupting work at a higher level. So if you wanted to hire McKinsey or Bain or Deloitte, you would have had to have usually a minimum of $1 million. Now you can hire a share of one of the workers who would have worked or could have worked for Deloitte, Bain, McKinsey, etc. Catalent is disrupting or attempting to disrupt the management consulting industry by offering you atomized shares of those same brains because they recruit at the same places that the management consulting firms recruit. The next one is automated. If you've ever interacted with a chatbot, you understand what automation is. So far, automation has been physical labor and some slices of routine cognitive labor, simple tasks. I think an interesting example of automation is Automated Insights, which is built on the Watson platform that will take a pile of data, sports scores, or financial information and turn it into a narrative story. It's the only example I know of right now that's easy to understand, at least, where automation has taken a pile of raw materials and created a nearly finished good. So that's a sign of, I think, of where things in terms of automation could be going. And then augmented is extending the human potential. It's a tool that makes the human more valuable. So one example of it, and you see the picture there, is the Da Vinci robot, where the surgeon can do more precise laparoscopic surgeries. IBM Watson is used with doctors and lawyers and a number of other people. It helps doctors read MRIs more efficiently and quickly, and it helps analysts, legal analysts, understand legal briefs. So this collectively is a shift in our relationship with tools. So as we adapt to continuous disruption, one of the things I think is helpful is the agile learning mindset. It's a concept that I've developed along with Chris. It starts with agency, understanding motivation, self-awareness, your personality types. It includes learning agility, the ability to learn, unlearn, know your learning styles, know your optimal learning conditions. It has a focus on the uniquely human skills, empathy, social intelligence, creativity. Those are all the things that are very difficult to automate, and they're also all the things we've sort of left behind. And then it includes adaptability with navigation, ambiguity, and working with unstructured problems. This framework I came up with to help people understand the types of assessment we're going to have to go through as technology continues to advance and even at more rapid speeds. So first you start with your current role and how you define yourself. Write that down on a piece of paper. And then make a list of all the things in your work that could be automated or atomized. So all the routine things or all the things that can be broken off into a job fragment that somebody else could do. Then scan the horizon for new skills and knowledge. What are the new kinds of things you should be learning? As the business model of your organization continues to adapt and thrive? And then what are the new technologies that could extend your human, your own potential? And then collectively, this suggests what your next role might be or your next roles could be. And then this is sort of a rinse and repeat process. I've used this framework with a number of audiences. I was sharing the stage with some folks from Amazon Web Services a couple of months ago at the World Bank, and they said, we do something like this every 18 to 24 months. So depending on what industry you're in, this could be something that happens every couple of years, or you could be in an industry where it happens every decade or two. Another thing to do is to think about your network. Anne-Marie Slaughter wrote the book, The Chess Web and the Web, and acknowledged that some organizations have very cohesive or tribe-like networks where you basically just reinforce what you already know and you may remain rigid and struck and stuck in your current contextual reference. And that networks that are broader and include diverse perspectives are actually bridging and action networks. When they were looking at changing the UK healthcare system, they consciously sought out people with bridging networks to help them socialize change. And I've seen this happen in many organizations, that they identify individuals who can bridge and scan across different parts of an organization and bring feedback loops with diversity of perspectives. So sort of in summary of this section, and then we can kick this off into our talk. The way Chris and I both see it is in the old paradigm, we used to learn to do something to produce a unit of value. And now we need to learn how to learn. Learning and work become a combined act fueled by purpose. That's our why. The unit of value we produce becomes a byproduct. And if we continually focus as organizations and as individuals in constantly increasing our capacity and constantly scanning the landscape for new skills, the products and services you produce are exhaust from your learning. Those will work themselves out. If you stay focused on increased capacity, you're going to be just fine. So that concludes my little context setting piece of it. And I want to hand it back to Mike to field any questions or to pass it over to Chris.
Yeah, Heather, look, some questions are coming in. So if you would take a look at some of those while I ask Chris a question or two here, it'd be really helpful. So Chris, look, you've been working with Heather, and you've been working with a number of companies trying to apply this research and get some companies to sort of leap ahead, if you will, which isn't an easy thing to do given the type of change we're talking about. But you know, what have you seen so far or are working on in terms of best practices, routines, some promising experiments you've seen sort of on the frontier of where some folks are trying to implement this in a company?
Sure. You know, first, I think it's important to acknowledge that change is hard. And I know that sounds an obvious thing to say, but all of our instincts in business are really, I think, geared to pull us back to the thing that we know. And so we try to implement best practices or frankly create new best practices that move us toward the kind of future that is much more agile and adaptive. And yet we come, you know, sort of springing back as if we were on an elastic band that we were pulled back to sort of the habits and the behaviors that we have. And so the first, I think, best practice is to be very consciously aware of just how difficult it is to make some of these changes in your organization, how difficult it is and how uncomfortable it is for people to get out of that space where they, you know, where they currently exist. So as an example, you mentioned I am working with a startup. Mm-hmm. I'm functionally the COO of a growing company in Pittsburgh. We have been working to hire a team. When I sit down to interview people and I ask them questions that I believe are geared toward learning agility, they often have a difficult time answering those because they have, you know, come out of college and university with a resume that talks about the skills they've collected and the experiences they've had. And we ask them to think about, you know, an abstract concept that, or an abstract role that doesn't have clear skill definition or clear tactical daily execution, it's very uncomfortable. And so getting people, and by the way, I'll say, even as one who's worked on this topic with Heather for the last several years, it's easy for me to fall back into, well, I see on your resume you did this, and you'll be great for, you'll fit in that, that this is a square peg and that's a square hole, we're good. So I think it's the first thing that is most important is to be super conscious that this is hard, that it's asking us not just to exercise new muscle, but to build them. So I think there are things that we can take from other industries that have helped, kind of are modeled as learning industries, and to think about how we apply them into other business practices. For example, in the medical community forever, the concept of an M&M conference, morbidity and mortality, you're bringing interns and residents and doctors together to talk about what happened in these cases, what went wrong, and what did we learn from them? What would we do differently in the future? In the military and other industries, the after action reports to talk about what happened in that incident, what did we do, what did we learn, what will we do differently in the future? That question that, you know, I don't hear around board tables as often, but I think it's important to ask is, so what did we learn from this project? Now, that tends to, in the context of business, get people to think about, you know, all the things that went right. And we learned that if we do X, then Y happens. Let's do more X. We have a harder time asking the question, what did we learn from the things that didn't go right? And I think that, being punishing about failure, but actually, you know, in fact, celebrating failure as an opportunity to learn is something that needs to be brought to the table for discussion, and not just at the end of every project, but, you know, at the ends of meetings, at the ends of days of work. I work with a wonderful group out of Boulder, Colorado, called the Unreasonable Institute, and the name comes from the quote that the unreasonable man tries to change things that are difficult, and so therefore all progress depends on the unreasonable man. And at the end of every working session, they go through this simple routine, and it's called I like, I wish. And it's, I like these things that happened. I learned from them. I had a good experience around them. I wish these other things would be different. And it's a very simple way. And whether you use those terms or others, it's a very simple way to end a meeting, to end a project, to just bring a mindfulness about evaluation and learning into every action that you do in your business. So I think those are some simple things that just start to shift the mindset. We've also seen, and I think this is an interesting example out of PayPal, the idea of kind of rotations, and again, maybe stealing a little bit from medical training, but they have a high potential young managers program in which it's a 2-year program, and they identify their high potential future leaders and move them through the organization in 2 to 6 month residencies with different parts of the organization. And they're there to learn. You know, maybe it's accounting and finance, maybe it's marketing, maybe it's operations. But I think what really makes that program work is that they're not just coming into an organization to be the intern for the organization or to be an observer. They're also seen as bringing in, you know, sort of DNA from other departments to help kind of infect these different functionality with the new organization with learning from others. So they become a bridge amongst what could otherwise be, you know, learning silos in the organization. But give a young, again, these high potential young leaders the opportunity to experience and learn from all aspects of the organization, not just to take away, but also to add to the problem solving and communication within those groups. So I think those are two models that are certainly worth trying to consider in your organization. And both, I think, important because they really focus on the question, what are we learning and how do we accelerate that learning and share that learning throughout the organization in a much more efficient and scalable way?
Hey, Chris, that's fantastic. Just one question for Chris Heather, and then I'm going to ask you to field a few questions if it's okay. Hey, so Chris, if I get the core idea, Heather talked about one of the fundamental shifts is going from thinking about what unit of value that we predictably want to create and how do we put the right person in the right role to make that happen, to moving to a world where it's more important to increase capacity to do more things that we might not know exactly what they'll be in the future, right? And so across the life cycle of an employee, if you will, interviewing people on the recruitment stage to try to understand those who can increase their own capacity are going to be really important, right? So they can continue to learn and change as much as do something that they're already capable of doing. And then thinking about how you put structures in work, right? Like you talked about the kind of the after action review structure and those things. They're ways for teams to build more capacity, I'm imagining, correct?
Yeah, I think all of that is
Sort of
true.
increasing capacity across a number of different ways in the organization.
Yeah, and I think I want to start to answer that question by thinking about or asking us to think about capacity a little bit more abstractly. In the self-assessment tool that Heather just shared, it really talks about it's kind of talks about the jobs, the sort of what components of your jobs might be outsourced or where you sort of understand your capacity for learning. I think it's also important to dissect kind of what you do in a different way, to understand sort of what let's call it talents you've brought to the position that allow you to transfer those talents, in the form of your capacity to impact other parts of the organization, other projects within the organization more effectively. And the example I like to use, my brother is a superintendent of a school district in Pennsylvania. And we were talking one night. He's kind of nearing retirement. How he's doing that at a younger age, I don't know, but there it is. He said, I just don't know what I would do if I weren't an educator. That's the only thing I know how to do. So I could retire. I'm eligible to retire soon, but I don't know what I would do because his identity is entirely associated with being an educator. So let's kind of in the same way that assessment asks you to sort of disassemble or deconstruct what you have done. I said, well, didn't you a couple of years ago you had a very contentious teacher strike? I said, yeah, that was a really difficult time. And I said, well, what did you learn there? Well, he went through some. I said, well, you learned about negotiation and working with unions and compromise and contracts. I mean, that's a lot of experience. Yeah, that's right. And I said, and that's applicable to a lot of things. I never thought about it that way. Said, didn't you have an experience a few years ago where one of your school buildings burned down over a holiday weekend and over a very few days you needed to muster resources to make sure that those kids could go to school on Monday morning? Said, yeah, that was a really tough weekend. So what did you learn? You learned how to triage. You learned how to muster resources. You learned rapid project management. Aren't those capacities applicable to a lot of other things? And it was a brief conversation, but it was one that for the first time in his 20 or 30 year career, he stood back to think about what it meant to be an educator in terms of the capacities, the traits, the skills he needed, and how transferable those were to other things. And I think that we get to Heather's point, so in this funnel of I am a fill in the blank, I am a doctor, I'm a businessman, I'm a lawyer, that we don't think about the applicability of those talents into other capacities. As a leader in an organization, I would encourage the participants in this webinar to think about not just, though, that person over there, that's my business manager, that's my accountant, that's my head of marketing, but to look at how they execute the work they do for those kinds of base fundamental skills and see that, well, Charlotte in accounting is actually really good at negotiating with our vendors, and we have this other negotiation issue. Maybe she can be someone who helps our leaders there understand how to do that better. Let's understand her secrets, if you will, to do that. But instead we think, well, we need a negotiator for this tough contract. Let's go get a consultant to do that. Right. So we haven't well inventoried the capacity within our own organization, because we're very accustomed to, you know, slapping a job label on it and being done with it. So I would encourage leaders to, you know, as they go on to their day to day and throughout the week and beyond, to think about, you know, look at an employee not just as this is the person who fills this job description or this job title, but this is a person who has these unique capabilities that, you know, we could bring to bear on other parts of the organization if we would just allow ourselves to break down some of our siloed thinking.
That is a great example and a really good reframing for those of us who have to think about talent these days and where the talent exists and what they could do, particularly in an age where the jobs themselves continue to change. So, hey, Chris, thanks. Sure. Heather, you see any interesting questions? Want to field a few?
Oh, yeah. We got a bunch of questions coming in, and I think I'll tick through a few of them. And then, as I said earlier, any difficult ones, I'll send to Chris.
And I'll send them right back to you, Heather.
All right. Thanks. So one of the questions we got was from Amy, who asked if any schools are teaching management and change, any grade schools. And I have a couple of good places to look where people are doing this. Certainly we need to be doing it in every school, but at least I've got one or two to point to that I think are interesting. The folks at Khan Lab Academy have created a Khan Lab school. And it's a K-12 school. It's out in Chris's neighborhood, and I visited it a couple of years ago. Rather than organizing children by age, which they believe is arbitrary as organizing them by height, they organize them by independence levels and competencies, so that every student is responsible for mapping through a certain set of competencies. Every student is responsible for a passion project. Every student is responsible for both their own learning and the agency that goes with that, as well as teaching others. And that combined set of things leaves every student responsible for some form of management, management of themselves and management of each other. And then having that passion project, which is an open-ended project-based learning, they have to deal with a lot of change. So that's a really interesting one. It's very small, but they're doing some very interesting things there. 2 weeks ago, I was in Ohio speaking to the Ohio State Board of Higher Education. And while I was there, I visited the PAST Foundation. The PAST Foundation is a lab. It's not a school itself. They find they could be more effective if they're a lab that other schools come into. And they have all sorts of things going on where they have students working on additive manufacturing projects with industry. They have a future of food lab. They have all sorts of interesting things going on across the board and all different types of innovation. So students come in there and then they're based on their projects. They get some college or university credits through partnerships. So by the time they enter higher education, they've already worked with industry. They've already worked collaboratively on projects. They've already worked with cutting edge technologies, and they've already started working on some of the world's most difficult challenges. So if you're in Ohio, I highly suggest you go check that out. I wish that there were one of those in every major city and town in the country. So those are some, I think, good examples to look at. We certainly need more of them. Celeste asked about the issues of aging I talked about in gender fluidity, if that was just a first world situation. The gender fluidity point, I'm headed to Australia this weekend. I understand it's happening, that those changes are happening there as well as many other developed parts of the world. Aging is a bigger problem in Asia. We're also seeing youth booms in Africa and the Middle East. So while some portions of the developed world are aging, and we actually need immigration to fulfill our lower fertility rates in other parts of the world, we've got better infant mortality rates, not quite as much longevity. So families are still 5, 6, 7, 8 people, and not just 2 to 4 people as in the U.S. and other parts of the developed world. So those are two questions. Somebody asked about examples of increased capacity. So I think Chris addressed some of this, but it brings up, between those last two questions, it brings up something else that every time I'm working on this, I'm working on this all the time, I've created an entirely new talk since I submitted this deck to you guys. So I have another model that I'm using now, and that model is of an iceberg. So I talked about agile mindset, and I talked about identity. The iceberg is sort of how you bring it all together. So We've been lunging at skill sets for the past couple of decades. We talk about how to robot-proof somebody. Everybody needs to learn to code, and if we just had more people in STEM. I was partly inspired by David Deming at Harvard's research that shows, not just now, but going back to the 80s, having high math and science skills are great, but without high social skills, those jobs are actually in decline and have been for 40 years. So if you have high math and high social, those are the most in demand and highest paying jobs. If you have high social and low math, those are the second most in demand and growing and high paying jobs. We've left a lot of this behind in our educational institutions. So I was inspired to sort of make a simple graphic. Unfortunately, I don't have it for you today because it was something I just made yesterday, of an iceberg. In the top layer of the iceberg, the thing you see outside the water is skills. Those are the skills to do. Those are the things we keep lunging at. Those are the things we keep trying to hire for. And just below skills are what I'm calling enablers. Those are the skills that make you better at your job. So that's creativity, collaboration, social emotional intelligence, empathy. Generally, you're not hired to do those things, but you're hired to have those things in your arsenal to make you better at what you do. Mm-hmm. Right below that and below the water entirely is mindset. That's your ability to learn and adapt. That's the agile mindset. And then all the way at the bottom of the iceberg, upon which all of this rests, is identity. If you're not secure in who you are and comfortable in who you are such that you can learn, try, and fail, you understand your purpose, you understand your passion, you understand what drives you, you can't develop mindset, you can't develop enablers, and you certainly can't develop skill set in any enduring way. So those are the four layers of sort of iceberg rock I think we need to be thinking about, and we need to be thinking about them at in work, because we can't just reskill people. We can't just codify a new set of skills into people. You need to develop the whole base so that people can continue to learn and adapt. So going back to our set of questions here, I think increasing capacity, I think Chris answered that for the most part, but if you look at any organization that shifted from one business model to the other, in the process of doing that, they need a different set of skills, and they could throw everybody out and try to hire a new set of people, but often you lose all the tacit knowledge in the process of doing that. You kill your morale, and it's a very difficult process to go through. So one of the examples that Chris and I have been using is the concept of the first moon landing. When we went to the moon, we couldn't hire an experienced moonwalker. We couldn't hire anybody who's done that before. We just had to hire people with high levels of learning agility, even though that's not what we knew. We didn't know that as a term at the time. We didn't even know what the questions were to be answered. The questions and the answers were roiling around each other. So we think you need to take a moonshot mindset to hiring certain types of talent. Yes.
I was just going to say, look, this is I imagined that we were going to have more questions than we have time, and it appears that I was right about that. Hey, it's a good sign. First of all, you two are just fantastic, doing some great work, shaping the way leaders and people and organizations are rethinking a whole bit about how work and learning needs to change way more fundamentally than we're actually doing right now. So I want to do a few things here as we close up. So first of all, I'll say thank you to everyone who is attending. The questions are great. Hopefully you've enjoyed the session and learned a great deal. Special thanks to Heather and Chris for spending time with us and informing the conversation as they have. And for those who are interested, the recording will be available. We'll send it to you. We have your emails or ways of getting it soon, so we'll send that out shortly. And in closing, I just want to say, you know, we're in December, so just hope that everyone has a safe and healthy holiday season coming up, and just want to wish everybody the best. And we're going to continue doing these. If you have some feedback for us at Duke here, please send it along and what you'd like to hear about or know about or be thinking about. So just want to say thanks. And thanks again, Heather and Chris.
Thanks for having us.